Niggas getting money is always a reason for a nigga to get down. Shit, it separates the strong from the weak. And every nigga getting it is always at risk to get it took. To lay down or get down. That's on some movie shit. But this here, this ain't no movie. This shit is real. This shit here is the ski mask way.
Black Hand Entertainment, Rockefeller Records, in association with the streets, the Black Gangster, in conjunction with everything official. Yeah. I ride through the ghetto, windows down halfway. Halfway out of my mind. Music on 9, blasting Donny Hathaway. Me and my niggas spending half the day. Plotting how we gonna get this map today without getting blasted away.
Let's go, bro, let's go! Everybody on the goddamn floor. You shut the fuck up! You are not saying nobody gets hurt.
His name was Chazz Williams, and it's the late 60s, early 70s. His forte was bank robbery. And this was one of the many banks he'd robbed. And it's because of these robberies he'd received status. The status of being a wanted man.
The pictures look straight out of a Hollywood movie, but the terrifying bank holdup was very real as three masked robbers stormed the bank with weapons drawn, jumping on counters, pointing guns at security guards inside. They fled in this maroon Oldsmobile that police found 20 blocks away afterward. It was apparently stolen.
Investigators say two men held up a Charter One bank on North Harlem in Harwood Heights. They made off with cash.
Chazz Slim Williams, the notorious bank robber who robbed as regular as news footage shown on everyday TV. The creator of Black Hand Entertainment, whose hand literally reached out to everyone from 50 Cent to Jay-Z to Foxy Brown. But that was a part of life that became entertainment. Before that was the real. The real 50 be rapping about. The slick shit Jay be singing. All that shit was rap. And as good as it sold, nothing could really outsell the true feeling, the description of what it was really like.
I think it's just like an adrenaline rush. I mean, you know, you just be focused on what you got, what you're trying to do. You know what I mean? And it's not like what you get a feeling. It's not like something that you're doing is for fun or, you know, like to describe it as a feeling of that kind of, some kind of emotion you get. You know, it's like anything else. It's about business, and you know, you're going to take care of your business, and you're focused on what you're going to do. It's a life and death situation, and anything dealing with life and death situation, it sort of has an adrenaline rush. A certain amount of your adrenaline pumps up, and you know, you just deal with what you're dealing with.
An educated man arms himself with the knowledge of the trade he's in. For Chazz, that was bank robbery, but there will be others armed with the knowledge of his trade as well. And surprisingly, their knowledge would lean towards justifying the bank robbery.
In this country, we have a look today at the resurgence of one of the most old-fashioned ways for criminals to steal money. Bank robberies rose 5% last year over 2005. And as our Justice Department correspondent, Pierre Thomas, discovered, we may need to rethink the old adage, the crime doesn't pay.
At least 23 banks are robbed somewhere in the U.S. every day.
As soon as I heard the gunshot and I turned around and looked at them, I was fearing for my own life.
The robbers are overwhelmingly men, often showing up in costume, masks, wigs, even in drag. These suspects posed as police to get inside this Jackson, Mississippi bank. Most bank robberies are surgically swift, over in minutes, largely because of little security. Many banks don't have armed guards or anything separating tellers from customers. The robbers are taking advantage of the relatively weak security, and it appears crime does indeed pay a lot. Half of the bank robbers don't get caught, and the overwhelming majority of the cash, more than 80% of it, disappears. Of $352 million stolen in bank robberies from 2002 to 2006, only $58 million was recovered.
According to statistics and according to Chazz, robbing banks came easy. The money came fast, and because of the climate, the cycle was on repeat. But just like a slave master's chain, soon the cycle and lifestyle would be broke and Chaz would be in jail.
Jail, for anybody, I think that prison is probably the closest thing you get to being dead. And I think that in that sense, you take it as like it's a process of taking you away from, you know, the loved ones. You know, you're taking away from everything, you know what I'm saying? And I was in for 15 years, 15 straight years, actually. And, you know, I did probably like five before that, so I got about 20-something years in. But when I was in the feds, I've been to quite a few, Terre Haute, in the earlier parts, I think, with Milan, Michigan, Terre Haute, Indiana, Atlanta Federal Prison, Lewisburg Penitentiary.
For Chaz, being a federal inmate meant he'd be shuffled around as if he was a soldier on tour of the Army. You know, that being all you could be shit. But before he could really be, he would first have to face how he got caught.
Somebody got caught, you know, somewhere else, not anything that had anything to do with me. I mean, directly anyway, but a guy got arrested. And he contacted the FBI and he said he had information on me and him, my crew. And he bargained his way out. Bargained his way, not out, but into the witness protection program. If you do what we do, then you know the consequences if you're captured. You know what I'm saying? If you commit yourself to a certain lifestyle, this is what it is. There's no excuses for telling. You know what I'm saying? And the same thing, like I said, if you go into a bank, that's the reason you wear a mask. Because you automatically know those are witnesses. They're not snitches or whatever. You know what I'm saying? You don't walk in there like, you know, with your face all open and just go to doing your thing. So I think that, again, there's a misconception about, and I think the police promote that misconception so that people just think like, oh, these guys is crazy talking about no snitching. What do you mean? You know, if I see a crime, then, you know, you're not talking to the average citizen that's walking around law-abiding. He works every day. You're not talking about him. You're talking about people who are committed to a certain way of life, and that commitment entails that you do not tell the police. You do not betray your confederates. You know what I'm saying? And that's what it is.
20 years of Chaz's life would be spent in jail. 15 alone based on the testimony of a snitch. And for Chaz, that only meant time was about to be in trouble. Because time would now have to work for him. Chaz would instill black hand principles into the free world, and there would be those who at the time would agree. 50 cents.
The 50 cents thing is really like way back during that period of time, just before that time, that I had co-managed him, you know, and that's like really kind of like some old movies and stuff. For me, 50 Cent has always been the same guy he is today, you know, I mean, in terms of who he is, you know. He's always been, you know, he's always been who he is. I mean, when he didn't have money, he was cocky and arrogant, and when he got money, he's cocky and arrogant. So to me, he's the same guy, you know, he's no different than what he was then. He's just a lot richer.
Foxy Brown.
Right now I'm working with Foxy Brown, Graf, and Fess.
I've been in the game 14 years strong, like officially as a, you know, as a signed artist, 14. And again, if you do your homework on me, from every nigga I fucked with since I was 14, he was a live gangster nigga. Like, I just have a thing for live gangster niggas. Like, I still do VIs, I'm still up north, I'm still in the feds. Like, going to see dude, like, I take care of a lot of niggas. And I also knew right across the BQE, there was a gangster, you know what I mean, a real live, lasted real true gangsters. And I knew who, you know, I knew it was Chazz Williams, and I knew that I wanted to be a part of whatever he was a part of. I called Chazz. I got Chaz, and I'm about to went to the hood, went to a couple live niggas. Yo, I need Chaz, nigga Chaz now. He hit me back. I called him. So what's up? It's Fox. Who? I was like, it's Fox. Fox who? Foxy Brown. I'm like, yeah. He said, oh shit, baby girl, what's up? I'm like, what's up? I've been looking for you. Where you at? And he's like, yo, go. Come on, let's do it. And it was from that moment on, I've never felt like, I mean, with the entire team, like I love the entire Black Hand team. I would do anything for any one of these niggas. Like, I love all of them.
The love of a Foxy Brown was equal to the love of the streets for Chaz. But it also presented a fear of his past to authorities. It was estimated that Chaz was responsible for the loss of several million dollars to a mind-boggling 60 or more banks. It's also because of those statistics and a recent upswing in bank robberies that authorities have become more aware of this problem and imposed stiffer penalties. The penalty Chaz paid was 20 years of his life confined, but nevertheless not wasted, as he returned to society with the same passions and convictions, but directed in a new direction. Chazz Williams, an original, the Black Gangster.
Jigga, over. Roll with me now.